Good evening. I'd like to call to order the regular business meeting for the Loomis City Council for Monday, August 12th, 2013. At this time, I'd like to call upon Councilmember Goodwin for flag salute, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Morris, would you please take the roll call?
I will, Mayor. Mayor Goff?
Pleased to be here.
Council President Lauren Simmons?
Present.
Council Vice President Sid Roberts?
Here.
Councilmember Mark Smith? Councilmember Carrie Lonergan-Drecke?
Here.
Councilmember Benjamin Goodwin?
Present.
Councilmember Van Obeschan? Councilmember M. Christopher Boyer?
Here.
Council members, if I may mention, there's one thing we do need to do. We haven't fixed it in our rules and whatnot, but we do need to allow, like Van, to be able to call in. We need some rules to do that, to call in and participate. We've done it on one occasion for a medical issue, but we do need to do that, just as an idea. We've done it several years ago because Ted, for example, was in the hospital with his knees, couldn't move type thing, and so we need just to do that. Van would have liked to participate, but mentioned it was the last meeting work session, and Council President reminded me that they don't have any rules there, so it'd be a good idea for us to do that for those occasions when it is really needed. At this time, approval of minutes, Councilmember Karen Lonergan-Drecke.
Thank you, Mayor.
Wow.
I move to approve minutes from work session July 25th, 2013, the special business meeting of July 29th, 2013, the special work session of August 5th, 2013, and the work session from August 5th, 2013.
Second.
So moved and seconded to adopt the minutes, which are listed on your agenda this evening under items 30A through 30D. Council members, are there any corrections, additions to the minutes at this time? Looking left, right, don't see any. This time, all those in favor of approval of the minutes, please say aye.
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 Those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. That gets us down to, unanimously, it's only five tonight, so, okay. There are no messages and papers from there. Moving on, citizen comments and communications.
I'm sorry,
I didn't go to the left.
You overlooked it.
Council or Vice President Sid Roberts, that's okay.
Thank you, Mayor. I move to excuse Council.
But you did hit me under the table.
Yeah, I kicked you under the table. I move to excuse Council Member Van Obeschan from the August 5th work session and the August 12th business meeting for medical reasons, for real.
Second.
It's moved and seconded to approve an excused absence for Council Member Obeschan. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. Sorry about that. That gets us down to citizen comments and communications. We have three people signed up. After we call those three people, then anyone who wishes to merely put their hand up will call upon them to be able to come forward. Rosemary Zeno, please come forward. For the record, could you give us your name? Spell your last name, please. Give us your address. Thank you.
It's Rosemary Zano, Z-A-H-N-O-W. I live at 19412 40th Avenue West, apartment 208, Linwood. And I'll try to make this short because I know you have a lot of things on your agenda. But there's some things that have come to my attention that I find very disturbing. There's no people that I respect more than city employees, especially our first responders, whether it be medical, fire department, or police department. And I'll tell you why I have so much feeling for that. My son's father was a Seattle police officer for 30 years, as well as his younger brother and his uncle. And when I find that police officers have to go out on a call and they don't have the proper equipment, I find that disturbing. And I'll give you, for instance, it may be a simple noise complaint. You make the call to the dispatcher and you Inform the dispatcher you want the officer to have a noise decibel machine. She said, certainly. The officer shows up in time, and he's prompt and courteous, and he says, I'm sorry, ma'am. He says, we don't carry noise decibel machines. He says, I wouldn't even know where to get one. Second call, same thing happened. Officer shows up, oh, sorry, ma'am. He says, we don't carry noise decibel machines. We don't even know where to, I wouldn't know where to get one. Third instance, just happened Friday. I have a picture I'd like to show you if I can. Mr. Mayor?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead. See,
I have a picture.
Go ahead, no problem.
Okay, this is Friday. This is from the Camelot West building. Those smokestacks you see there, that's Net River. And from 12:16 until almost 1:30, the noise decibel reading was 78, 79. And the smoke coming out of that stack was a smell of burnt oil. And it continued the entire time. Now, I also have a tape of that noise. Can I play that for you?
Sure.
Now, understand that I'm
too... You have 3 minutes like everyone
else. This is why I'm forgetting some of the things I wanted to say. I'm 250 feet away. That's 250 feet away. From 12:16 until almost 1:30, and this happens quite often. The officer was called. The officer showed up on the site, called me. He said, yes, I'm here. Yes, I hear the noise, but I don't have a noise decibel machine. He says, I can't tell you what it is. I says, well, I can, but they won't accept that. He says, well, the gentleman here says they have a permit to do this. But he hasn't shown me a permit. He says, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going over to the permit department, and I'm going to find out if he's telling me the truth. Well, what a coincidence. Permit department is closed on Fridays. So I went over this morning, and I asked the young lady behind the desk. She looked it up on the computer. She said, there is no such permit that could give them the right to do that. She said, they didn't have a permit. I don't know what else to say, Mayor. We've said it all. It goes on and on. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Okay. We have two more people on the list. Annie Peterson. Please give us your name. If you spell your last name, it would be helpful. And your address, please. And good evening. Once again.
Yes. My name is Annie Peterson, and my home is 427 101st Avenue Northeast in Lake Stevens. And I work at Snohomish Health District at 3020 Rucker Avenue in Everett. And I'm here tonight in support of adoption of the tobacco-free parks ordinance that is before you later this evening. I again brought the sign that I was at the work session that would indicate a partnership that Snohomish Health District would fully support if you were to adopt this resolution, or rather this ordinance. It fully is in line with Linwood moving forward as a healthy community that supports trying to model what wonderful healthy behavior is like for youth in your community. Current park rules for Linwood and a lot of other parks already have things on the books that have some regulation as to what behaviors are allowed in parks. Leash law is a pretty common one. People who own dogs are welcome to use parks, but dogs can't run free, and owners are responsible for making sure they pick up after their pets. People who golf are welcome to use parks. But they can't tee up and practice their drive in your parks, except at possibly the golf course, which I learned a whole lot about last week. People who love to camp are welcome to use parks, but they can't light a campfire anywhere they want and pitch a tent. People who love horses are welcome to use parks, but they can't go galloping across the main grass areas of parks. People who like a glass of beer or a glass of wine are welcome to use parks, but they cannot do that activity when they are choosing to use beer or wine. Those are all really common things, and the reason those things are in place is because those kinds of activities are things that can interfere with someone else's ability to enjoy their parks experience. Tobacco use is no different from those things. Tobacco use is another thing that can interfere with other people's ability to enjoy their park experience. And in the case of secondhand smoke around play areas or any other areas in parks, it also can be a significant health danger to people with asthma or with heart conditions and any other things. There's no question that litter in parks is a huge issue that maintenance staff would just as soon not have to deal with. Tobacco, cigarette butts being the most littered thing that needs to be picked up on beaches. Fire issues are always a relevant issue where there are bark chips, especially in summer, or where there's dry grass. The other thing that is important about this is it frees park staff to be able, if there is an ordinance in place, to not be in a position to have to intervene in situations that they may not be able to handle. And this allows them just to call the police. I would remind you there's no constitutional right to smoke. People who smoke are not covered under any kind of federal civil rights laws or state laws. This is a behavior, and it should have some regulation, just like other things that interfere with individuals being able to enjoy their parks experience.
Thank you. One last person, and then we'll touch on one thing on the first speaker. Mr. Wirch, Harold Wirch, could you give us our name, your name,
yeah,
please,
yeah,
and then spell your last name and your address, please?
Okay. I'm Harold Wirch. Last name is W-I-R-C-H, and my address is 2676 Elm Drive, Briar, and I guess I could give you a couple more things. I'm retired traffic engineer for Snohomish County, which I think some of you already have experienced my coming to see some of you before. I am also on the Sound Transit's Oversight Panel. I recently joined Snohomish County's ADA ADA Committee, and I'm also on the Briar Planning Commission. And I'm here basically because Maria of your Planning Commission has asked me to basically present a couple of thoughts I've got on basically on 184th and 184th and 42nd place off Maple, to basically try to calm the traffic going through there. These are just proposals that you can look at, and I'll just let you look at them. Basically, one looks at a one-way exit onto 44th, a couple of traffic circles, and a roundabout on Maple. That's just for you, along with some bulb outs. So I'll just let you look at that. I also have a AutoCAD file of this if you need that.
Mr. Wirch, we have a specific traffic calming program and whatnot, and it'd be important that as much as we're up here doing this, we do have specific public works staff, and the director is available this evening to get this information
to
him.
Sure.
They actually measure the projects to be
sure.
Done.
Sure. Yeah. Right. No, these are just some things that Marie and I also looked at 176th and 60th. The sidewalks there end on the south side, and it's rather dangerous for somebody who is not as able to walk around as you or I. So I'll leave that with you also. The other thing that we talked about was ADA, and a part of that in my coming here in this case is that since I am on the Snohomish County's ADA council or committee, does Linwood have such a committee on ADA?
We'll check it out with the Public Works Director in terms of dealing with primarily our infrastructure. We do have that. I don't recall if he has an exact group.
No, but basically, we in Snohomish County are willing to work with the other agencies to try to come up with some uniform. We've just got started, so we're not really ready to proceed in that direction. The other thing that I'm interested in is we have a wheelchair person on the committee, but we don't have a blind person. If any of you happen to know of a blind person that lives in Snohomish County that would be interested, we would appreciate that. And the other two things I've got are some sketches of the intersection to the south of us here and to the north on 44th for improvements like what Snohomish County is starting to make on ADA. Mm-hmm. And if you're interested in actually seeing some of that, if you go to 228th and 45th, we have done those at that locations, which was signalized before we did the ADA. Now the ADA is in. You can see how we retrofitted that, mm-hmm. if you're interested. So,
thank you very much. On 44th Avenue, we have a project coming up exactly, good timing, because we'll be redoing 44th, a number of intersections.
Oh, that's great.
We'll be looking at
that's great. Hour. I'd be willing to work with their staff if that's...
Thank you. Our time's completed at this point. Just if I can get Bill, not everybody. Bill Franz, Public Works Director. Mr. Wirch here needs to get in touch with you about traffic calming issues and suggestions that he has with regard to 44th Avenue, some of the ramps and other issues on sidewalks and whatnot. Just want to get you guys together immediately so you can talk about it, okay? That gets us down. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak this evening? Just raise your hand, then we can call upon you, and then we're going to go back to the first speaker just briefly. Yes, sir. Please come forward. Give us your name, address, please.
Sure. Thank you, Council Mayor. Ian Cotton, 7030 190th Street Southwest, Linwood Wall. So I have here in my hand a memo. It's just contains some recommendations concerning the golf course. I know that in the at the work session meeting the evening of August 5th, 2013, the findings of the Pro Forma Advisors LLC was discussed with regard to the recommendations set forth for the city to move the golf course into a profitable operation. I would recommend that the council, I won't quote everything, it's like a 50 or 60 page report, but just a couple highlights and recommendations here would be, at a minimum, to undertake the improvement items listed as high priority for the improvement by Pro Forma Advisors LLC in table V1 of the report, page 32, and recommend that an RFP be put forth for the hybrid model of operation. The RFP should contain language for those responding to list both the course maintenance piece and the administration management piece, portions as a separate ad alternate to the contract, and then allow the city departments to respond to the RFP as well to provide an opportunity for competitively bid between public and private sectors. So I see this as a golden opportunity for the city government to bring our golf course into good financial standing, preserve the green space resource that the golf course represents to the city, as well as provide a catalyst for the city to start to competitively price and bid things both with the private and the public sector. So that's it.
Welcome to Indianapolis and Phoenix. Okay. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak this evening? Merely have to put up your hand. Looking to the right, left, don't see anybody. Looking again, third call, final call. Okay. Ms. Zeno, do you happen to, I presume you usually do leave us at, do we have the picture and How do we get a copy of your sound things? Because I need to move that over to Director Kraus to take a look at this.
You'll just have to copy it, I guess.
No, do you leave the picture so we can copy it, or do you have extra copies of it?
I have extra copies of the picture.
Okay.
As far as the sound, I guess if you have a tape recording, you can just tape it off of that.
We'll need to do that, that's right. Okay. Well, thank you very much. I just wanted to just take a moment so we can gather what obviously is a new set of facts in my mind to take a look at that matter versus what we have gone through and taken a look at.
I'm also very concerned as to why police officers don't have the proper equipment when they go on a call.
I assure you that I will ask the police chief that immediately tomorrow when we have a staff meeting and see if that's something that's within their normal
process. All three times, it was different officers, and they were just as frustrated.
I understand. I'm going to ask police chief whether that's what they do. Usually, what I hear from the police is that's what code enforcement does, and they have sound meters. Mr. Kraus, we do immediately need to take a look at this newer set of facts that I have seen with regard to what's going on out there. So we can chat briefly tomorrow about that, see what comes up with. We don't need to get in a big colloquy now. I just want to make sure that we've got the picture, and somehow we'll figure out the sound issue that we could at least get what she has and what she offers. So anything briefly?
Briefly, my recollection with Net River is that their monthly testing is something that they were told to do around noon during the week, which is the noisiest time of day. So I'll double check, but it could well be that.
No, I appreciate that. Clearly, it's a set of facts. Let's take a look at it rather than hypothesizing. Let's figure out date and time and ask them what they're required to do in order to check their generators or not, or what's appropriate, what's not. So, okay, thank you very much. No, our time's really out at the moment.
I know.
But Mr. Kraus, you'll have an opportunity. No.
Ask him to check CPAP. Yeah.
We'll do. We have to figure out what the issue is. They said there's a permit or permission. There may be a requirement somewhere that doesn't show up as a permit or whatever. That's what the police officers said. So we'll have to figure it out. So we'll put you with Jensen and figure that out in terms of the perception of the officer or whether it's a requirement or it's something else. So. We will work through it, continuing on. Anything else? I don't see anybody else. Okay, thank you. That completes that part of the agenda. Yep. Excuse me? Oh, we had a written one. Okay, here we go. Oh, I thought it was a hand up from one or the other. Okay. Council members, just to let you know, in citizen comments, we have received a written communication letter from Janice White, undated, regarding Royalwood HOA. Copies of this will be made available. Janice White, last name spelled traditional spelling for White, Janice, J-A-N-I-C-E, just so we have it on the record. And it's, goodness gracious, 1, 2, 3, 4 handwritten pages. And Beth, make copies for everybody. Okay, just want to acknowledge it. Huh? You've got it already? Okay, great, thank you. We've acknowledged it then. Take a look at it. Okay, that completes that item. Completes anything else? Yeah. Okay. Is citizen comments, communications? Okay. We're down at item 60, which is presentations and proclamations. We have a proclamation concerning Snohomish County recognition of the 50th anniversary of the 1963 March on Washington. Council members, it's in your packet, but I'll go ahead and read it for the record. Proclamation of the City of Linwood. Whereas 50 years ago, one of the largest and most memorable political demonstrations in our nation's history took place on August 28, 1963, called the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. And whereas, in addition to being a massive demonstration for civil and economic rights, it was also the 100th year commemoration of the Emancipation Proclamation, which marked the beginning of the end of slavery. And whereas, the March on Washington was the event where Dr. Martin Luther King delivered his now famous I Have a Dream speech, and whereas the March on Washington is often credited with the subsequent passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and whereas a 50th year anniversary celebration on the March on Washington will be held on Wednesday, August 28th at 6 p.m. in the Jackson Center on the Everett Community College campus, sponsored by the Snohomish County, Linwood's Neighborhoods and Demographic Diversity Commission, and several other community partners. And now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council, the City of Linwood, do hereby proclaim August 28, 2013, as the 50th anniversary on the March on Washington in the City of Linwood, and we encourage our fellow citizens to join in that anniversary celebration. Okay, there we go. Okay, council members, at this time, okay, thank you. Having read it, does anyone have the idea to do a motion to concur? Mr. Boyer, Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor. It would be my honor to move this proclamation, that the City Council adopt and support this proclamation from the mayor and the city. This is an important anniversary. It's also another important activity by our Diversity Commission. I'm proud that Linwood has such a body that continues to work hard to make sure that there are ample opportunities for our citizens across cultural boundaries to get to know each other and become friends. And the work of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King has been very important to me, and I'm proud to claim Reverend Dr. King as a fellow American Baptist pastor. So I wholeheartedly move that we support this proclamation.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to concur in the proclamation by the mayor. Is there any further discussion with regard to that matter? Looking left, right, don't see any time. All those in favor of concurring in the mayor's proclamation, please say aye.
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 Those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. That completes that item. We're at item 60B, National Disaster Preparedness Month. Council President Simmons.
Thank you, Mayor. The proclamation that I'm about to read is entitled National Preparedness Month. It reads as follows. Whereas National Preparedness Month is a nationwide effort held each September, and whereas the goal of the National Preparedness Month is to increase public awareness about the importance of preparing for emergencies and to encourage individuals to take action, and whereas no community is truly prepared for a disaster until every individual, family, and business takes personal responsibility for preparedness, and whereas citizens of the Lake Linwood should be encouraged to take steps to prepare for emergencies by having a family emergency plan, getting an emergency supply kit, being informed about local threats, and getting involved in community preparedness, and whereas the City of Linwood continually engages in disaster planning, emergency response, and sheltering. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Linwood, in recognition of this event, do hereby proclaim the month of September 2013 as National Preparedness Month. Your Honor, I would ask that someone might concur that the Council put their blessing on this.
Mr. Roberts.
We concur.
I think it starts with, I move that.
I move that we adopt that proclamation as the gospel.
Is there a motion to concur in the proclamation? Thank you. Is there a second?
Second. Second.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded to adopt, or to, get me going, to concur in the proclamation there. Further comments, questions from the council with regard to the matter? Seeing none at this time, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. That completes the proclamations under and presentations under item 60. And that gets us down to unanimous consent. Oh, excuse me, council comments. Council comments, starting with Council President Lauren Simmons. We'll go to your left since we went right much of the time.
Thank you, Mayor. The next item on our agenda is actually called the unanimous consent agenda, but I'm going to take the liberty here momentarily to jump ahead.
We Council are. Comments. You just listen.
He's rolling. He's rolling.
I said the next item is, well, get the peanut butter out of your ears. What can I say, guy? You know, The next item on the agenda is the consent agenda, and the first item on that is the confirmation of a reappointment of a lady by the name of Marie Warnick to the library board. And the reason I am bringing this to your attention is that Marie Warnick has been on the library board for 14 consecutive years, and she has a good number of those years been the chairman. And she is a very fine lady, loves the library, and has a wonderful spirit, in many ways an excellent example for all of us if we were to do volunteer work. And I just want to go on record tonight before we actually confirm that of saying, Maria, if you're watching this or if somebody tells you about it, thank you. You have been a real blessing to all of us. The second thing that I would bring to your attention this evening is that a little less than a month from now, I believe the 11th year of Linwood University will kick off on Thursday, September 5th at 6 p.m. right here in the council chambers. And I know that there are two or three people that are sitting in this audience now that can tell you what a thrilling experience it is to put on a fire suit, climb a 100-foot ladder, meet the SWAT team, come face-to-face with the canine units and a few of the other things like that. But the point is, there is still room if you are so inclined. It's an 8-week session. The price is free. It'll be a lot more valuable to you in the long run than sitting at home as a couch potato watching television. Trust me on that one. But anyway, if you've not gone through this program, I would encourage you to do so, and you may contact Julie Moore, whose number is 670-5023. Thank you.
Good. Council Vice President Sid Roberts.
Thank you, Mayor. Just wanted to kind of just touch on the event that happened in Seattle today. The Metro bus driver was injured, and a very sad situation. I'm sure you've watched the news. Our heart just goes out to the people that are involved, the individual who lost his life in the matter, has, I'm sure, parents and sisters and brothers, and yeah, it's a very unfortunate situation, and I'm just very grateful, however, for law enforcement that can head off a situation before it gets a lot worse, and so our hearts just sort of are out with them today. I also wanted to mention that I think some of you know this, but Shannon Sessions this is her last month. Shannon is the public information director at Linwood Police Department, does a great job, and if you know Shannon, just send her a card. She probably likes Starbucks cards, and you know, $100 bills are fine, whatever you want to send over there. She is being replaced by Lisa Wellington, and I think the month of August is Shannon's last month, so she will be missed. She's too young to retire. I don't know how that works when retirement, but she's too young to retire anyway. Lastly, we had a great time at the National Night Out on our street. We had about 30 in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. We were visited. It just so happened that night was a busy night at the firehouse and other places, I understand, or at least the police department was out on some serious matters. But we did have Mr. Mackey came by and gave a nice presentation, and we were very happy to do that. So National Night Out is just a great event. I think we had 33 this year, 33 National Night Out parties. So it's good. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilmember Smith, in the nick of time, council comments.
Thank you, Mayor. I apologize for being late. Given the length of the agenda tonight, I'll pass on comments. Thank you.
Good. Councilmember Goodwin.
Thank you. Due to the time constraints, I'm not going to pass.
I'll take my time back.
Moving on.
I do want to recognize, again, the wonderful proclamations that were read this evening. The March on Washington, of course, is a significant event in the history of this country, and those that were involved and are still involved in movements to help each other and to help the community. Secondly, the National Disaster Preparedness, that is something that is actually near and dear to me. I advocate very much about being prepared for things that can displace and put people out. and having that preparedness kit and having those tools available. If I'm not mistaken, when there is a natural disaster, it's often about 3 days before emergency help is able to get to your home. So having that kit and having the 3 days worth of food and water and those things is a big help. Fortunately for most of us, we haven't experienced that, but we never know, and so it's always something to be prepared for. And lastly, again, like Councilmember Roberts said, you know, our hearts go out to those that were involved in the incident in Seattle today, and wish a blessing on those that were involved and their continued safety. Thanks.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm also cognizant of how much we have on the agenda tonight, so I will refrain from making comments tonight.
Councilmember Lonergan-Drucki.
Just a couple brief comments. Since I'm sitting next to the good pastor, I just want to say an amen for all the fabulous weather we've had this summer. Thank you for ordering that. And then I'm sure very shortly we'll be getting back to a Council President Simmons Seahawk report on Mondays. So that's it for me. Thank you.
Only if we win.
Moving on. Are there any thank you all, council members, for your comments. We're not moving on to item 90 on the agenda, business items and other matters. Unanimous consent agenda, I believe, is Council Vice President Sid Roberts.
Well, since no one had much to say, would anybody like to read the consent agenda tonight?
Yes, you're it.
So it's about 16 pages. Yeah, I don't know how this lottery worked, but would any council member like to remove any item from the consent agenda? Okay, I move to adopt the following consent agenda items. Reappointment of Library Board Member Marie Warnick. Confirm and reappoint Marie Warnick to position 1 of the Library Board for a 3-year term which expires August 31st, 2016. B, reappointment of Library Board Member Matthew Mullen. It just seems like we just do it just to vote him in. Are you one of those folks here tonight? Confirm reappointment of Matthew Mullen to position 5 of the Library Board for a 3-year term which expires on August 31st, 2016. C, professional services contract addendum 1, Linwood Recreation Center, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, HVAC design. Authorize the mayor to sign addendum number 1 to contract 2199 with Ingenuity Systems of Tacoma, Washington for amount not to exceed $22,430. D, is this Presidio or Presidio?
Presidio.
Presidio, that's the way I would say it, managed support services, Cisco phones. Approve the support services agreement with INX LLC to continue support and maintenance for the city's telephone system covering the period January 1st, 2013 to December 31st, 2013 for an annual charge not to exceed $14,593.29, including tax. Item number E, Active Network Class Annual Maintenance. Approve the Active Network Annual Maintenance invoice covering class utilization from June 2013 to May 2014 for a total cost not to exceed $24,649.86, including tax. Item F, interlocal agreement to join Alliance for Housing Affordability, AHA. Authorize the mayor to sign an ILA for an initial 2-year membership in AHA. This authorization would, we don't know what those are, but whatever they are, this authorization would include payment not to exceed $2,151 for fiscal year one and a comparable amount for fiscal year two. Item number G, final approval, utility system SCADA upgrade project. Grant final approval for the work performed under the contract for the utility system supervisory control and data acquisition, SCADA, upgrade Schedule A, fiber optic cable installation, and Schedule B, SCADA equipment installation project, subject to the requirements for appropriate state and federal agencies, if any, and ultimately release of the retention, if any, to the contractor, as is consistent with the adopted financial plan. Paragraph H, or item H, agreements 2012 to 13, amendment of Department of Ecology Solid Waste Grant. authorize the mayor to sign the amendment to the agreement with the Washington State Department of Ecology for a coordinated prevention grant funding our part-time solid waste recycling coordinator. Item number I, consultant contract, wastewater treatment plant heat exchanger project. Authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a supplemental agreement with Gray and Osborne Incorporated of Seattle, Washington, for the purpose of providing construction management services in the amount not to exceed $21,800, and as is consistent with the financial plan. And lastly, and not least, item number J, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $1,444,377.97 and $1,095,638.92, respectively.
Thank you. Council members, is there any last-minute questions, issues? If not, consent agenda as read is adopted. Council members, a little update on our schedule this evening. Special legal counsel has arrived. We will now be doing an executive session. I checked in with the council president. We're going to do that executive session here in just a couple minutes. It'll start at a quarter of the hour on this clock and go for 20 minutes, not to exceed 20 minutes, unless we need to come out and extend that. So first item is, without objection, council members, we need to move to item J on the agenda. Is there objection? Hearing none at this time, that's where we're at. At this time, the purpose of the executive session is potential and actual litigation issues. And at this time, we'll adjourn to the bigger room. It's too warm to be in the smaller one, that's for sure. And we'll start that in about 2 minutes. And we'll go for 20 minutes, and then we'll come back out and deal with the 90.4 business items. And that's about it. Any last-minute questions? Seeing none, hearing none? We're moving on. Thank you. We're at recess for executive session. Thank you. I'd like to call the Linwood City Council regular business meeting back into order. We were on recess for the purpose of an executive session. Executive session ended exactly on time. And at this time, we need to move. Council members, we're at 90.4J officially at the moment. So we'd like to ask you, we do the following. Without objection, if it's okay, we'll move to item H. Without objection, purpose simply being is this is the agreement that was on 2 weeks ago, and at the special business meeting it didn't happen to get listed, therefore, and the sponsors are here of that project, so they're the ones that have already been up one other time. Ask without objection, we move to item H. Is there objection? Hearing none at this time, we're at item H, and Councilmember Boyer, according to the yellow sheet, you are up, sir, not for a motion, but you have the opportunity, procedurally. This particular item under number H already has a motion and second. And at the time of the last business meeting, we did a motion to continue the motion and second, to continue it over till tonight. So we start at the point of already having a motion, already having a second. And the issue is commentary, council members, or debate with regard to where we're at. Mr. Boer, you have the opportunity to speak first if you wish to.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a quick comment. The reason that I brought this as a motion last time was because I believed and still believe that this particular project meets the criteria that the City Council had in mind when they designed the TRIF exemption, the traffic impact fee exemption, for the first, I believe it's possibly three qualifying projects within the city center zone. It seems to me this project meets those requirements. It's a good way to start off with more city center development. It's adding something special to our city with more affordable housing for senior citizens and housing in general for senior citizens. In general, it looks like this like this is going to be an asset to the city and a good way to move forward. So I would encourage my colleagues also to back this and approve this particular project for the traffic impact fee waiver. Thank you.
Okay. Further discussion, council members? Please indicate your wishes to say something in particular, anything. Mr. Boyer, it sounds like you've said it all right there. At this time, the matter before you is the motion to approve the development agreement as set forth on page 90.4H-4 for those at home or in the minutes so we can make that notation, and that's what the action is before you at this time. Council, all those in favor of approval of the development agreement, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, please say no. Nay. At this time, the agreement is adopted unanimously. Okay. And that completes that item. Council members, appreciate your we're working with Council President to organize this particular sequence, if you will. So we have completed items J and H. Unless there is an objection, I would ask that we move back to item 90.4A at this time. 90.4A is the ordinance, basic ordinance with regard to B3, B4 zoning and amendments thereto. Mr. Kraus, did you want to say something in particular? Because the amendments, you want to make sure we get off on the right right foot, I guess is the best thing to say.
Your Honor, these code amendments had been reviewed several times by the City Council and prior to that by the Planning Commission. And during the process, there were a series of amendments essentially designed to improve upon the certainty that multifamily development would not occur in a way that was detrimental to single-family neighborhoods that were nearby. The most recent amendments, well, included not only the establishment of a minimum lot size for consideration, but also the use of a conditional use permit, plus amendments to the city code that would actually illustrate which lots, which B3, B4 lots, are available for consideration, not an automatic approval, but available for consideration for housing. And with that, the last time the council had seen that, they indicated that they were ready to act on the ordinances, and therefore they're on tonight.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize Benjamin Goodwin, Councilmember Extraordinaire, for the purposes of a motion.
Thank you. Ordinance number, please.
3010.
I move that ordinance number 3010, an ordinance of the City of Linwood relating to commercial zoning, consolidating the B3 and B4 zones into a single zone, B3 neighborhood commercial, amending references to the neighborhood business zone, amending chapter 21.46 LMC, LMC 10.12.400, LMC 21.16.310, LMC 21.40.100, LMC 21.40.900, and LMC 21.48.100, and providing for an effective date, severability, and summary publication.
Second.
It's moved and seconded to approve ordinance number 3010, the title of which has been read as part of the motion. Councilmember Goodwin, maker of the motion, you have the opportunity to speak first.
Thank you. Aside from what Director Kraus said, there are some other key features that I just want to mention quickly. One is that this will actually consolidate two outdated and underutilized zoning districts into one. It'll assist in development potential, as he stated, of some of these vacant lots and underdeveloped properties. So, you know, one of which is has been mentioned previously as a bit of an eyesore for some residents. So doing something like this will definitely help and allow for medium density housing on parcels at least 1 acre in size, up to 3 stories or 45 feet, whichever is less. So I urge my colleagues to join with me in approving this ordinance.
Thank you. Further comments, council members, with regard to ordinance 3010. I don't see any request for recognition at this time. Therefore, Ms. Morris, would you take the roll on ordinance number 3010? Those in favor, yea. Those opposed, nay.
Yes. Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Lonergan Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yes.
Six yes, zero no.
Ordinance number 3010 was adopted unanimously. That completes item A on the agenda. Moving to item B, which is an ordinance zoning map amendments. Now that we've changed the underlying text and issues there, we now need to deal with the map item. And Councilmember Carrie Lonergan Drecke, please.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Ordinance number 3011. An ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, amending the city's official zoning map and providing for an effective date, severability, and summary publication. So this is just a formality to change the actual zoning map. We talked about the reasons behind changing the code. This is just changing the zoning map.
I'll second that motion.
So moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3011, the title of which has been made, been read as a part of the motion. Councilmember Lonergan Drecke, the opportunity to speak first.
No further comments.
Okay. Other comments, council members, in regard to the matter? Seeing no requests for recognition at this time, Ms. Morris, would you please take the roll with regard to ordinance 3011? All those in favor, yea. Opposed, nay.
Yes. Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Lonergan Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
Councilmember Mark Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Six yes, zero no, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3011 is adopted unanimously. I want to mention for those people in the audience and those people at home maybe watching this again, we try to state this probably about once, at least once a night. These items, this one in particular, has been on for several months back in work sessions and perfected, and suggestions were included and improvements. The work sessions are where the work takes place. What you're seeing here is actual decision making with regard to something that's been going on for quite some period of time. And we even had a hearing on the particular matter, too. Moving on, we're at item C. Councilmember Mark Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. I move ordinance number 3012, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, superseding ordinances 2942, 2868, and 2832.
3013, I think.
Sorry?
I thought it was 3013.
Could I have an ordinance number, please, Beth?
3012.
Thank you. It's quite all right. Just gives me an opportunity to start over.
That's right.
There you go.
I move ordinance number 3012, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, superseding ordinances 2942, 2868, and 2832, and providing for additional construction project funding for the wastewater treatment plant secondary system standby emergency generator project at the wastewater treatment facility, and providing for severability, establishing an effective date, and providing for summary publication.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3012. Right, 3012.
Yes,
right. Councilmember Smith, right on target there. At this time, Councilmember Smith, maker of the motion, you have the opportunity to speak first.
During the installation of a new secondary standby generator, it was discovered that there was a problem with the power source. And so Public Works has come to us for additional spending authority to make sure that this works and our treatment plant continues to operate the way we all want it to operate.
It's kind of important, yeah. Further comments, council members, with regard to this matter? Again, another item we've worked on in discussions. Anything else? At this time, Ms. Morris, would you take the roll? All those in favor, yay or similar, or those opposed, nay or similar?
Councilmember Lonergan Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yay.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Six yes, zero no, Mayor.
Good. Councilmember Smith, item two.
I move that the council authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city supplement number 16 to existing contract number 1796, task A1 with Gray and Osborne Incorporated for additional construction administration services for assisting in resolving the reformulated voltage issue with the WWTF power supply in an amount not to exceed $53,126.
Second.
Moved and seconded to authorize to enter into a supplement number 16 with existing contract 1776, task A1 Gray and Osborne to further the purposes of ordinance 3012. Maker the motion, Councilmember Smith, the opportunity to speak first.
No, thank you.
It's already been said and done. Right? There you go. Thank you, sir. Welcome. Okay. Is there any other comments? Looking left, right, with regard to this matter, don't see any. At this time, all those in favor of entering to supplement number 16, Gray and Osborne contract, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay, that completes that item. I'd call upon Councilmember M. Christopher Boyer for item D, please.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move the adoption of ordinance number 3013, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing project funding for the 176th Street Southwest Channelization Road Diet Project, an ordinance authorizing expenditures in Project Fund 356 and authorizing funding allocations and reimbursements from grant funds and consistent with the project financial plan and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
So moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3013, the title of which has been read as a part of the motion. Councilmember Boyer, the opportunity to speak first.
Thank you, Your Honor. This is a project that will restripe 176th Street from four lanes to three lanes. That's two through lanes, one each direction, and a center turn lane, plus bicycle lanes between 52nd Avenue West and 44th Avenue West. The purpose of this is to perform what's called a road diet, which is an effective measure to slow traffic on that particular street, which has become a bit of a problem. So this is a safety measure, and it's well within our budgetary resources to handle this.
Councilmember Boyer, I only have one question. Is there any advantage to citizens driving down that street?
Yeah, it'll be safer.
Oh, will there be a diet activity or anything?
No.
Okay,
road diet doesn't do that. Would okay. that it did, I'd be standing out on 176th Street waiting for it to happen.
I hear you. Thank you. Further comments, council members, with regard to that? Councilmember Goodwin.
Thank you. While I consider this project beneficial, some concerns that I have that I didn't bring up earlier because I've been doing a little research, and something I think we should continue to look at is the use of bicycle lanes generally have been found to have little effect on the safety of bicyclists. They tend to be a little more complacent. Being a bicycle rider myself, I understand that, and when you have the bike lanes, cars generally see that as, oh, the bikes are there, we're here, there's less caution and less worry. So as we look at projects like this in the future, I think I would urge us to look a little deeper into whether or not bicycle lanes really are beneficial and provide for the safety of the citizens, not to mention the general loss of property value as it takes parking off the street in some cases. So that's another thing that we may look at. I'll be definitely approving this, but as we look in the future at projects like this, if we could. Thank you.
Okay. Further comments? Councilmember Lona Gregg.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. I want to echo those same concerns from my colleague, and I had a question for Director Franz. Is the bike lane going to be on one side of the street or both?
No, this street, the plant, well, let me back up and say that the what you're approving tonight is actually the design portion, where the consultant is going to look at that the possible layouts of going to a road diet on this, implications to capacity, because when you go from four to three lanes, we are concerned, will capacity be impacted to the point where we shouldn't do this? So this is actually going to be the first look through design, and if there's issues or reasons why we need to do something different than what we talked about with you now, we'll come back and talk to you. But the plan initially is to look at bike lanes on both sides. There is no parking on either side of the street. So really here the main capacity or main issue we have is capacity and how we're going to treat the bike lanes through the intersection of 99 and 176 is something that's kind of tricky too we need to look at. So again, this is the design portion. We'll be back to tell you what we find out.
Okay. All right. So, thank you.
Yeah, Councilmember, this is like a lot of the others, where we come back and we consult and get your ideas with regard to design and before we go down the road, do that. Councilmember Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. Bike lanes have been a hot button issue in this city in the past, and I would encourage my colleagues who are, as a proponent of bike lanes, as a very strong advocate of bike lanes, I would encourage my colleagues who may not be as full of fervor as I am for bike lanes to bring such evidence rather than just make a statement that they've done some studies, because they've done studies like that with crosswalks as well, which say that crosswalks actually have the effect of making pedestrians more complacent and making drivers complacent, yet ultimately we keep building crosswalks because they are proven safety measures for people crossing streets. So I would encourage us, if we're going to look at this, if you're going to oppose something, that you bring some evidence-based material to oppose it. Thank you.
Further comments, council members, with regard to the matter? Not seeing any at this moment. Ms. Morris, would you please take yeas and nays roll call on ordinance number 3013. Those in favor, yea. Those opposed, nay.
Yes. Go ahead. Council President Simmons?
Yes.
Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Lonergan-Drecke?
Yes.
6 yes, 0 no, Mayor.
Ordinance number 3013 is adopted unanimously. That completes that item, except for part 2, which is...
Right here?
Councilmember Boyer. Yeah, I'm sorry. I was just checking to see what we had. Go ahead.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. I would move the following, that we authorize, city authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with KPFF Consultant Engineers of Seattle, Washington for engineering services in an amount not to exceed $23,000, including management reserve and as consistent with the financial plan.
Second.
Moved and seconded to enter into a contract with KPFF in order to fulfill the purposes of ordinance 3013. Mr. Boyer, maker of the motion, I have an opportunity to speak first.
As usual, when we adopt an ordinance, we then have to quite often turn around and actually give the mayor the authorization to spend the money that we've just suggested. So this motion does that.
And receive those professional services necessary to make it happen.
Yes, indeed.
Absolutely. Anything else, sir?
No, sir.
Council members, any comment with regard to the motion at this point? Seeing none at this time. All those in favor of authorizing entry into the contract with KPFF Consultant Engineers, as set forth motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. That completes that item. Councilmember Goodwin, we're heading your direction on behalf of item E.
Bring it on. Let's.
Can I get an ordinance number, please?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
3014.
Ordinance 3014, thank you. I move that we adopt as a council ordinance number 3014, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing project funding for the SR99 and SR524 Adaptive Signal Control Project. An ordinance authorizing expenditures in Project Fund 356, and authorizing funding allocations and reimbursements from grant funds, and consistent with the project financial plan, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Do we hear a second, please?
Second.
So we moved to adopt ordinance number 3014, the title of which has been read as a part of the motion. And Councilmember Goodwin is the maker of the motion, the opportunity to speak first.
Thank you. As stoplights tend to also make people feel complacent. No, I'm just kidding.
Moving right back to that. Moving right back. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. No, the ordinance is it's a request to prepare design plans, specifications, and estimates for the implementation of an adaptive signal control along Highway 99 and 196th Street. The fantastic part is that the project is fully funded by the city safety grant with no local match required. So for us, I think that's a pretty darn good deal.
We like that.
Aside from some monies that we will be required for the design plans themselves, the project itself is funded, so that's that.
That's that. Okay. Councilmembers, further discussion with regard to that? Oh, we've got both of them. Councilmember Lana Kondrecki, then Councilmember Smith. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor. Personal question. How do you pronounce your last name? Because I hear it two different ways. I figured, you know, I should probably know this before my term is up.
We go by Franz, although the German is Franz.
So right, okay.
I answer to either.
I know you do, but I like to pronounce people's names correctly, so it is Franz. Okay. Thank you for that.
Sure.
Director Franz, a couple questions here. Do we have a sense of what the long-term costs might be for the equipment for this project? Yes, I understand we have a grant for the study. But I like to be thinking long-term when it comes to costs and design as to what this might entail. I know that our current traffic management plan or equipment was a significant cost, and there's also maintenance that has to be really budgeted too at the same time for replacing equipment.
This program here, Adaptive Signal Control, actually utilizes the ITS system.
Mm-hmm.
And Adaptive Signal Control were the later phases of ITS, which we didn't have funded. But what was funded with prior grants was construction of this wonderful system. What this does is allows us to take that next step and design into that system this adaptive control. I don't have a great answer. I don't think the costs are to maintain it in the long term are necessarily any greater than what we're already invested now in doing with the ITS system, since this is just a kind of a further design software venture into not a hardware venture.
So it is more software than hardware?
Yeah.
And one of the benefits of utilizing a system like this is apparently reduced collisions. My understanding is that red light cameras are also supposed to be reducing collisions, too.
No comment on that part. But what I will comment on is what this allows is real-time, instantaneous information from one or more signals in the sequence to then have an input to instantaneous changes in signal timing in that system. So using the cameras and the traffic counting and all those things that are available in the ITS system to then recognize what's going on and what the needs are in that sequence of signals to change them and to have them work smoother.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Further, Councilmember Smith?
Thank you.
Okay.
Director Franz, on 90.4F-1, number 2, the pedestrian countdown traffic signal heads, I had a question and a concern, if you will. The City of Everett and the City of Seattle have installed a number of these. Am I on the wrong? I'm on the wrong item. Never mind.
Okay.
I'll wait till the next one.
There you go. Bill, hang around. We got to go back. Okay. Is there any further discussion about Ordinance 3014, which is where we're at? Any further comments, council members? Seeing none at this time, Beth, would you please take the roll on Ordinance 3014? Those in favor, yay. Those opposed, nay.
Yes, Mayor. Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yay.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Lomnick and Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
6 yes, 0 no, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3014 is adopted unanimously. That gets us to Mr. Goodwin, part 2.
Part 2. I move to authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with DKS Associates of Seattle, Washington for engineering services in an amount not to exceed $71,000, including a management reserve and as consistent with the financial plan.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to authorize the entry into a contract with DKS Associates of Seattle with regard to implementing Ordinance 3014. Mr. Goodwin, make the motion. Opportunity to speak first.
Thank you. Just some administrative actions to follow the adoption of the ordinance.
Further comments, council members? Looking left, right, don't see any at this moment. All those in favor of entering the contract with DKS Associates of Seattle to assist in implementing, excuse me, ordinance 3014, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. Okay, we're down to Councilmember Lana Kondrecki. I believe you have number F.
I do. More traffic safety improvements. Ordinance number 3015. I move ordinance 3015, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing project funding for the citywide safety improvement project, an ordinance authorizing expenditures in Project Fund 356 and authorizing funding allocations in reimbursement from grant funds and consistent with the project financial plan, in providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3015, the title of which has been read as a part of the motion. Councilmember Lana Kondrecki, the opportunity to speak first.
Right. I did have a question of Director Franz. The item here about permanently mounted radar speed signs, was that one of the streets involved is 204th?
Yeah, I believe right now we're looking at using two of those on 204th.
And then what other streets are involved?
I don't know at this point. I'm not sure if we've decided yet or we're looking at our candidates still from the traffic calming program.
And then what, can you speak about the implementing the flashing yellow arrow and where in the city those would be installed?
Well, I can't tell you a whole lot beyond what's stated here. There's 30 intersections that we've looked identified out of our 57-ish. So half or so. I know I'm going to, I heard your question already, Mark, but I'll let you ask it again. Also on the same issue, I believe. No?
So I'm not familiar with what Federal Way is doing. They've got a flashing yellow arrow for left turns versus, if I'm remembering right, that's just kind of a warning letting people know that
it calls more attention to what's going on. Because, you know, when you're acting on a yellow, somebody can be coming the other direction.
Right,
and
right.
It wakes up the driver a little more.
And is this also grant funded, 100%?
Yeah, you probably noticed that the whole slug of these were from the same grant program. We put in for a list of different safety improvement grants and received most of them, so yes.
Okay. When do you anticipate starting the installation of the flashing yellow arrows?
I have to get back to you on that. I'm assuming probably next season.
Okay.
But.
Yeah. All right, thank you. No further questions.
Councilmember Smith.
Thank you. I think I'm on the right item now. About the pedestrian countdown traffic signal heads, both Everett and Seattle have installed a number of these, particularly Seattle, but also Everett where I work. And what I've noticed is that whereas before you would have the little white man walking signal, white colored LEDs would change to the flashing red hand, which would change to the solid red hand. Now you've got the little white fellow walking across changing to descending numbers. But when that number hits zero, indicating how long pedestrians have to cross, when that number hits zero, the traffic signal turns yellow at the same time. I've witnessed a number of times when there's only 2 or 3 seconds left, people think they have time to cross the street, and so they enter into the intersection, and it's particularly hard for cars that are trying to turn left from approaching traffic or cars that are trying to turn right from that lane suddenly have no time to turn. And I've witnessed, I was part of one, and witnessed a couple of other near collisions between vehicles and cars, and or between vehicles and pedestrians, and so that leads me, I guess, to two questions: is there a way to time that so that it counts down to zero, and you get the solid red hand at zero, but there's still a number of seconds left on the signal light. Do you see what, you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And are there, and I haven't looked at our code around this, does our code indicate when people should and shouldn't be entering the crosswalk with these pedestrian countdown signals? In other words, it indicates you shouldn't be entering it when it's a solid red hand, and I believe it says you shouldn't be entering it when it's a flashing red hand as well. That's the indication to continue crossing if you've already entered the crosswalk, mm-hmm. but not to start crossing. But I don't believe our code says anything about these countdown signals, and so it kind of leaves people wondering, you know, oh, can I get across here in 2 seconds? And if it takes me 4, what does that mean?
I'd be surprised if our code did, because these are new. I do know that that the federal requirements are requiring all new signals, and when you make changes to signals to put this technology in, what I don't know offhand is what kind of, if there's any variability in how they're designed and how they operate pursuant to the type of questions you were just asking. So I'm going to have to get back to you on that also.
Yeah. Well, just speaking from personal experience, last week I was at a meeting in downtown Seattle and started across an intersection when there were 4 seconds left. I'm a tall guy, I walk pretty fast, not realizing that there was a car trying to turn right, that red truck, and he was pretty irate.
Yeah.
So in order to avoid those kinds of incidents, yeah. What can we do?
I think it probably, one thing I can offer for sure after finding out answers to those questions is to do some education through some of our publications in Linwood University and things like that to start getting that word out, because we're going to have to go to these things. And you're right, you raise good questions. Does 3 seconds really mean 3 seconds, or does it mean 3 seconds plus some more time after that? So it's a good thing for the public to start understanding is how those things really work. Yeah.
We should look at that. Council members, we had historically in the city before they were taken out a number of years ago, way before my time, what we called some safety seconds when the lights were changing in the intersection. There would actually be an all red condition for a period of 1 or 2 seconds, so everything's all stopped. We have done those. I would urge Bill, when you get back to him, see if there is an ability to put something in there as which would provide for what Mark's talking about, some safety second cushion. So when you get there, it doesn't automatically begin to trigger. So we'll see if there's something we can do on that. If it is software, we should be able to take a look at that. Thanks for bringing up Councilmember Smith, so we can zero in on that. Okay, further comments? Did I get everybody on that? Okay. At this time, what is before, I don't see anybody else seeking recognition at this time. What is before you is the adoption of ordinance number 3015. And at this time, Beth, would you take the roll call? All those in favor, yay. All those opposed, nay. Go ahead.
Okay. Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Lonergan-Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
6 yes, 0 no, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3015 is adopted unanimously. Okay. Part two, please.
Yes, I move to authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with DKS Associates of Seattle, Washington for engineering services in an amount not to exceed $74,200, including a management reserve and as consistent with the financial plan.
Second.
So moved and seconded to enter into a contract with DKS Associates for the purposes of implementing ordinance number 3015. Councilmember Longdrick, you have the opportunity to speak first.
No further questions.
Okay. Anyone else? Any issues there? Don't see it. Okay. At this time, all those in favor of entering into the contract to help implement ordinance 3015, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay. Moving on, Councilmember Smith, item G.
Thank you, Mayor. Ordinance number, please.
Yep.
3016.
Thank you, Beth.
Mm-hmm. Oh, excuse me, Mark. Could you just spend just for a second? Council members, we're really close to the end here and whatnot. I'm sorry we got into a little bit more discussion. Is it okay if we forego a break? We got a couple more to go do, which are not that not that controversial. And then there's a quick couple scheduling motions, and then
just keep rolling.
Over. How's that sound? Okay, thank you. Excuse me, Councilmember Smith. Thanks for suspending there just for a moment. Go ahead, sir.
I move ordinance 3016, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing project funding for the SR-99 and SR-524 Safety Improvement Project, and ordinance authorizing expenditures in Project Fund 356, and authorizing funding allocations and reimbursements from grant funds, and consistent with the project financial plan, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3016, the title of which is included and read in the motion. Councilmember Smith, the opportunity to speak first.
This is a project that will make some safety improvements along Highway 99 and 196, otherwise known as SR-524. Among those are installation of advanced street signs. If you're not familiar with the area, it gives you a little bit more warning of which streets are coming up. Installation of internally illuminated overhead street name signs, and my favorite.
Yes.
Replacement of thermoplastic intersection pavement markings with methyl methacrylate pavement markings. We have been waiting for years for that in this city. The best thing about this is it's entirely funded by a grant, and there is no match required from the city.
What more could you want? Perfect program, zero match.
See, it pays to wait long.
Yeah, there you go, right there. Further comments with regard to the ordinance? I don't see anything looking left and right. At this time, Ms. Morris, would you check the roll? Those in favor, yay. Those opposed, nay.
Councilmember Goodwin.
Yay.
Councilmember Boyer.
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts.
Yes.
Councilmember Lonergan-Drecke.
Yes.
Council President Simmons.
Yes.
Councilmember Smith.
Yes.
6 yes, 0 no, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3016 is adopted unanimously. Councilmember Smith, Part 2.
I move that the council authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with CH2M Hill of Seattle, Washington for engineering services in an amount not to exceed $231,000, including a management reserve and as consistent with the financial plan.
Second.
Moved and seconded to enter into a contract in order to implement ordinance 3016. Councilmember Smith, the opportunity to speak first.
No, thank you.
I think we probably discussed it. Enough as we go. Okay, just looking left, right, don't see anything else. Seeing no further requests for recognition, all those in favor of entering into the contract with CH2M Hill for the purpose of implementing ordinance 3016, please say aye.
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 All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Okay, there we go. We are now down to Mr. Boyer. You have taken number H, and we've already done that a little bit earlier, just marking where we're at. So we'll move on now to item I. Council Vice President Roberts.
Ordinance number, please, Beth.
3017.
3017. I move an ordinance to the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, prohibiting smoking tobacco products in city parks, amending section 10.16.020 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, and providing for an effective date and severability and summary publication.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt ordinance number 3017, the title of which has been read as a part of the motion. At this time, Council Vice President Roberts, you have the opportunity to speak first.
Thank you, Mayor. I want to thank Annie from the Snohomish County Health District for very well articulating very well much of what I would have wanted to say about this. Over 700, almost 800 cities across our country, major cities and two states, have banned smoking in parks, in public parks. And, you know, this is not an attempt to demean in any way someone who chooses to smoke. I smoked for about 10 years. Grew up in a family. My dad sold tobacco wholesale. I understand the tobacco industry. But the one thing I will say is that just as early as this week, I was at Spruce Park, and there was a number of young people playing basketball, and one person sitting on the side lit up with a lot of other young people there. This is just really affirming and codifying the understanding that we currently have in the parks. And so I'm just urging my colleagues, it's not a popular motion or a popular ordinance necessarily with those who smoke. Those who don't seem to have the same problem with it, I will say. I was sort of surprised at the amount of publicity that this ordinance brought. I thought it would have been a little more common sense, but I urge my colleagues to support it.
Further comments, council members? Councilmember Lonick-Andrecky?
Mayor, I did have a question for City Attorney Rosemary Larson. I guess one of the biggest reasons I'm on the fence about this is that initially when Councilmember Roberts was talking to the council and myself about this, we were also talking about the importance of, well, if we're going to codify no smoking tobacco in our parks, we really should be dealing with the marijuana issue. And this ordinance addresses alcohol, which has been a standing, you can't drink alcohol in public parks or in public. And yet, there's nothing here about marijuana. So I wanted to hear straight from you why that is.
The reason that marijuana was not mentioned in this ordinance is that there is a state law, the I-502, that then legalized the use of some small amounts of marijuana, also has a provision in it that prohibits the use of any marijuana in public view, which would include outdoors in a public park. So that activity is already covered by a state law that prohibits it.
Right. However, when this was explained to me at a work session a week ago, there was some talk about how the state initiative apparently prohibited local jurisdictions from prohibiting marijuana use in their jurisdiction. And I'm not, that doesn't make sense to me because local jurisdictions have the ability to regulate alcohol. So why is it that we can't regulate marijuana? And I want to say, too, that, you know, we started out with the no smoking tobacco ordinance, or not ordinance, but it started out as a resolution and an understanding that this wouldn't take place. So, and now we want to take that to the next level. So I really think that we're doing ourselves a disservice by not addressing marijuana.
Well, I do know you couldn't have anything in here that would conflict with the state law, which only prohibits the use of those small amounts of marijuana in public view.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay, so then we could amend this to include marijuana. Is that what I'm understanding?
I haven't actually looked at that. So if that's something that the council's interested in, you know, we could look at that further. I will say that it's already something that that the police could cite if, you know, the marijuana is being smoked in open view. And I also understand that there is an ordinance in the works that's going to amend the city's criminal code relating to marijuana issues.
Yes.
And so it could be that if it turns out that we can do something consistent with state law along those lines, it could be added into the criminal code.
Well, if we amended this ordinance to include marijuana, how would that not be consistent with state code?
I think if it said, it probably would be consistent with state law if all that it said is that you cannot smoke marijuana or use marijuana in open view.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Which would repeat state law. We can repeat state law.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
Let me mention just one additional thing. The state has never had regulatory authority with regard to liquor. That was the state liquor control board, and they kind of exempted or preempted the area and whatnot, so we didn't have a whole lot of things to say there. We might have been consistent with them, but we did not have individual authority to kind of change, for example, their licensing and that kind of stuff. Councilmember Roberts.
Well, I just wanted to say, are you kind of... Mike, here, do you want to speak? Initially, when we first began to talk about this, the marijuana issue was in there. But having talked to MRSC about the actual marijuana law, it is quite vague. What it says is that you can't smoke marijuana in public view, which the bushes is not a public view, in a tent is not a public view. What the way I read this law, this ordinance, and I'm not certainly not an attorney, is that smoking of any tobacco in the park, it would be illegal, and that would be a misdemeanor, and certainly our police department could enforce that. As it is, if someone is ticketed for smoking pot, as I understand it, it is not a misdemeanor, it's a ticket, and any funds that are collected go straight to the state. So I think this, I don't know if this will help, but I think this is a first step, and I wouldn't be opposed at some point when the law's clarified to come right back with a different ordinance that addresses that specifically.
And as noted, the police have already prepared it. We have been preparing to address this issue specifically in the criminal code, so we have to conform, make some adjustments. And we are watching carefully what Seattle does because they want to make a local prohibition also. So we'd like to be able to follow along and be able to do that, which has a revenue, allows some revenue to come in, so police to help do enforcement and whatnot. So, yep, we're going there. That's where our intention is at the moment.
So, clarification again from the city attorney. Again, I thought I heard you say that we would be well within the realms of state law if we wanted to add an amendment to this proposed ordinance. Just reiterating that small amounts, whatever that quantity is, I don't remember, is anything above that. No, I'm sorry, that smoking of marijuana is not allowed in our parks.
You would have to mimic the state law, which, and I believe that, as Councilmember Roberts said, it's that the state law has the prohibition on smoking marijuana in public view, I think is the phrase that the state law uses.
Okay, so again, I don't understand why we can't add that to this current ordinance. And why the fact that the police are coming up with another ordinance to clarify marijuana, to me, that it shouldn't be an either or.
I mean, I guess that's a policy question for the council, if you want to have something that, you know, reiterates what's in the state law.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So is this a good time for me to propose a friendly amendment?
You could do a friendly amendment. I presume it would be probably a real amendment, because, if you want to do it, could we get to Mr. Smith and I'll come back?
Sure.
If you want to, you know, think of something. Councilmember Smith, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say to my colleagues and everybody else that I fully support a ban on smoking marijuana, smoking cloves, cigarettes, smoking whatever it is people want to smoke in our public parks. The issue for me is smoking. I would urge us to stay within the confines right now of this ordinance as it's written, because the state law is so vague, because the Attorney General's office is still trying to figure out what it means, because the Association of Washington Cities and the Municipal Research Services Council have both advised cities to proceed cautiously on this, and because there is always, in my 8 years of experience on the council, unintended consequences when you try and write legislation from the dais. It's better, I feel, and I very much support what you're saying, Carrie, Councilmember Alana Gendrek, excuse me, but I think it would be in the best interests of the city at this point to move this ordinance forward as is and revisit this issue as soon as we can, as soon as we've received some clarity on the points.
Councilmember Alana Gendrek, you're recognized for the purpose of an amendment. We have other people who want to speak to the general issue and maybe
well,
an amendment. So go ahead.
Yeah, and I'm happy to defer to other people that do want to speak first.
That's fine. Thank you very much. Council President, you wanted to, you sought recognition?
I did.
Go ahead.
I was I think the only council member that attended the I-502 hearing that was held in Everett at the Hanson Convention Center, along with one of our staff people from community development, Gloria Rivera. I went with specific questions in my mind and got part of those answered along the way. But I will tell you the one statement that I heard that leads me to be a little bit queasy about amending this thing right now is that when you have the people up front that have the responsibility of figuring this all out and they use phrases like this is a work in progress, it leads me to think, I don't know if I want to get out there too far at this point until they figure out what they're doing. And they have acknowledged that, and I think they're probably working frantically to get clarification on it. But I would, you know, not that I would be uncomfortable supporting an amendment to this one at this point, knowing that I sat there and listened to that and heard them make that statement. So,
yeah. Councilmember Boyer, you're the only one who hasn't. Did you want to speak to this? Carrie was kind enough to just say whatever you want to say first before we maybe do an amendment or not. So go ahead.
Sure. Yeah, just briefly. I don't know that I can add anything to this conversation, but I tend to be of the same mind as some of my colleagues who've spoken, which is, A, the marijuana issue is already covered by state law. B, state law is in an incredible condition of flux right now as regards its possible applications and determination of what it really means. So I'm not sure that this, even as I spoke for the moratorium a couple of weeks ago, I think the similar thing presides here. We don't know for sure yet what the state's going to do, how they're going to apply these laws. I think a cautious attitude of wait and see is best when we can indeed fall back on the fact that state law says not in public view, and how that's applied in our parks is somewhat up to our police department, at least for the foreseeable future. And the fact that they are, along with, I'm sure, city attorney, working on some language that will be a little more tested out, so to speak, gives me some assurance that this is going to come down the road. So with great respect, Councilmember Lana Gondrecki, because I support her aim, I'm not sure that an amendment to this ordinance is the best way for us to do this.
Okay. Councilmember, I've just checked. There's no further comments. Councilmember Lana Gondrecki, your final comments? Or?
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. I have heard the comments from my colleagues, and I would agree that that's probably a good course at the moment. But I do want to strongly urge the council to not let the issue of marijuana go by the wayside, because it really, I think, is kind of a double standard to be telling people who smoke tobacco, gee, you can't smoke in our parks, but we're kind of doing a hands-off right now on marijuana. I realize that the state law might be a little confusing, but I think it does send the wrong message, and I think there's a lot of very harmful effects with marijuana, probably even worse than tobacco in a lot of cases. And let's not let this go by the wayside, because if this is really about wanting what's best for our community and our kids, then going easy on marijuana is not the right way, in my opinion. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Seeing no further requests for recognition at this time, Beth, would you take the roll call? All those in favor, please say yay. All those opposed, nay, please.
Sure.
Beth?
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Council Vice President Roberts?
Yes.
Councilmember Drecke?
Yes.
Council President Simmons?
Yes.
Councilmember Aubuchon? Oops, sorry. Councilmember Smith?
Yes.
Councilmember Goodwin?
Yay.
6 yes, 0 no.
Ordinance number 3017 is adopted unanimously. Council members, got to turn the page here for a second. Okay. All right. Check on our agenda here for a second. We made it through item J, we've already done. At this time, we're at new business. Recognize, Council President, you have two scheduling motions.
I do, sir. Thank you.
Go ahead.
My first scheduling motion is for September 5, 2013. I move to hold a special work session at 6 p.m. on Thursday, September 5, 2013, for the purpose of holding Linwood University Session 1 Introduction to Linwood University City Government, City Council, Parks, Recreation, and Cultural Arts. It is anticipated that multiple city council members will be present for discussion and presentations. No final action will be taken at this event.
Brief translation, a quorum of four or more.
Yes.
Okay. Second? Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the scheduling motion with regard to Linwood University on Thursday, September 5th. Council President, do you have any remarks?
No, actually,
whatever you're.
the bottom line is that that's the night that the council or the majority of the council makes our portion of the presentation to Linwood University, and we're first thing out of the box. And we're anticipating that four or more will be there, which is a majority, so we need to let it be known.
Yep. Special work session. There we go. Any other comments with regard to this matter? Pretty routine. We do it every year. Okay. All those in favor of the scheduled motion, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion, scheduling motion passes unanimously. Okay. That gets us down. Council President, second scheduling motion, Sound Transit.
Yes. This one relates to September 14th, which actually I think is a Saturday,
mm-hmm.
2013. I move to hold a special work session at 10 a.m. on Saturday, September 14th, for the purpose of holding the third Sound Transit Community Outreach Meeting at City Hall Council Chambers, 19100 44th Avenue West, Linwood, Washington. It is anticipated that multiple city council members, possibly four or more, will be in attendance. No final action will be taken at this event.
Clarifying the motion before the second, and that is, at the moment, we need to nail the location down that is believed to be the place, or we will advertise the place if for some reason there's another time. They are just working on that, and I thank Beth for helping out and getting that thing taken care of. But the motion would be adjusted to say, or such other location as may be finally determined. Is there a second?
Second.
So moved and seconded to indicate again, scheduled a motion for a special work session of the council, four more members, a quorum thereof may be present for forum number three on Sound Transit 2 community outreach meeting. Council President, you have the opportunity to speak.
No, sir. I think it's pretty self-evident. It's number three on the Sound Transit.
We're doing it again.
Yep. We're doing it again. So.
Any further comments, council members? Looking left, right, don't see anything else. All those in favor of the motion, scheduling motion, with regard to Saturday the 14th, number three, forum, Sound Transit 2, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, nay. Motion passes unanimously. Council members, is there any other new business item? I don't see any recognition. Unless there is an objection, we are adjourned. No objection, adjourned.